This is Petrinet's introduction part 2. So we are going to speak first about generalized Petrinets. What is a generalized Petrinet? We can call a generalized Petrinet if there are weighting factors associated to the axis. In this case, these are integers, as you can see here, 3. So normally in the elementary Petrinets we got 1 is the weighting factor associated to each arc. In this case we got different weighting factors. So the question now is how to validate and how to fire a transition in a generalized Petrinet. So in this case we need 3 tokens in P1. So we just have 1, so this transition is not validated. And we need 1 token in P2, so we got 2. So in this case I, the transition 1 is not validated. Also, in case 2, it is not validated because we just have 2 tokens in P1 and we need 3. So the only when we have T1 validated, we need to have 3 tokens as we have here now. Okay, now in this case we have 3 tokens in P1. So we take 3 tokens in P1, this is validated, and now the question is how to fire the transition. How does the firing of a transition works for a generalized Petrinet? So in this case, as you can see here, we got 3 tokens in P1. So, and we got 2, which is more than 1, so T1 is validated. So the fire, we are going to redraw 3 tokens from P1, 1 token from P2, and we are going to make a deposit of 1 token in this P3, which is missing here, and 2 tokens in P4. So, as you can see here, so 1, 2, 3 are redraw from P1, 1 is deposit in P3, and now 1 is redraw from P2, this one, and we are going to deposit 2 in P4, which is also missing from this drawing. So there is not a physical correspondence between the tokens which are redraw from the input places P1 and P2 and the tokens who are deposited in the P3 and P4. So you are going now to consider one example which we are going to model with a generalized Petrinet. So in this case we got 2 parts, part A and part B, and parts A enter one by one to buffer A, and parts B enter one by one to buffer BB, buffer B, and after that there is a machine which is going to assemble 2 parts from buffer A with 3 parts from buffer B, and this assembling is going to result in another product, a product R, which is going to be deposited in this buffer, BR. So this is the output from this manufacturing system. So the question is how to model this system with a Petrinet. And I'm going to provide you a solution, and the solution is this one, and I'm going to explain you step by step. So here we got T1 is a source transition, and T2 is a source transition as well. When we fire T1, it means that one part A is going to enter in buffer A. So P1 models buffer A, P2 models buffer B. So after that, we need to have 3 parts from B buffer A and 3 parts from buffer B, 2 and 3, to be assembled in machine M. Okay? So then, after being machine, the part R is moved to the buffer R, which is modeled by this P4, and then we got a source transition represents the part leaving the system. So we are going to consider a possible firing sequence, transition firing sequence, which is this one. So it's, for instance, we fire T1, it means that we got one token here. Okay. If you fire T1 again, we got another token here. So we got now two tokens here. Okay. And now we got, if we fire two times, T2, then we got two tokens, no, three times, we got three tokens in the place two. So now we got enough components to assemble the first component R. So when we fire this transition T3, we are going to redraw two tokens from this place P1. This one is going to leave, and this one is going to leave, and three from place P2. So this one is going to leave, this one is going to leave, and this one as well. And we are going to deposit one here in P3. So this means that the machine is operating or is assembling a part R. Okay, when it finish, when we fire T4, this token leaves this position, and we are going to have a token here in this buffer BR. So when the part leaves the systems, when T5 is fired, this token is redraw from this position. Okay. So this is this corresponds to firing this frequency of transitions. So okay, as the machine can only produce a part at a time, we need to limit its capacity. So the question is how to limit the capacity of the place. And for that, we are going to introduce the finite capacity PetriNet. A finite capacity PetriNet, we got places like this one, P2, with this label. Capacity of P2 is 2. What does this mean? This means that this capacity of place 2 cannot be exceeded. In this case, 2 cannot be exceeded. So when we fire the first time P1, so this means that this token is redraw from this part, and this one is deposited here. And if we fire again T1, so we take another one here, and we had another token in P2. And after this, because of this limitation, we cannot fire T1 and again before T2 is fired. Okay, so the question, so this is a definition, and the question now is how to transform a PetriNet with finite capacity into an elementary PetriNet. So what you want to do, we want to limit the capacity of a place with an elementary PetriNet. So in this case, these two PetriNets are equivalent. So if I want to limit the capacity of place V2 to 2, I have to add a complementary place P-line 2 with two tokens, and in this way the capacity of P2 cannot be is maximum is 2. So we cannot have more than two tokens in P2. And so if I fire once T1, this token is leaves this place, and this one as well, and we got one token here. And if you fire again T1, so we'll redraw this token and this one, and now we got two tokens in P2. So the capacity of P2 is 2. So we don't have tokens in P line 2, so this empty place is limiting the capacity of P2 to 2. So a rule, a mathematical equation who can model this is this one. The marking of P line 2 is equal to the capacity of P2, which in this case is 2, minus the marking of P2. So initially this is 0. So this is always 2, no matter what is the evolution of the PetriNet. Okay, so now I'm going to show you how to limit the capacity of the motor to 1. using this rule. Okay, so as you can see here, I added another place, this one. So P3 was modeling the machine operating, machine on, and we got another place here. We can call it P-Line3, which is going to limit the capacity of P3 to 1. So this means that this the modeling significance of this P-Line3 is that the machine is off. So when we fire T3, it means that we got here one part. When we got one part here, this leaves this this place, and now I cannot fire again T3 before this token leaves this place. When this token leaves this place, then I got a token here, and I got again a token over there, which is enabling the firing again of T3. Okay, so with this example, I show you. So there's another question here, but maybe I'm going to leave you as so you can think about how to limit the capacity of the buffer BB26. I mean, I want to limit this capacity to 6, and because this is a generalized PetriNet, you have to think a little bit about it. Okay. So to conclude, there's a reference book by René David and Hassan Allah, which is well known, this one, and also this is in Portuguese, in UTAD, the modeling and control with PetriNet that you can have. Okay, and with this I'm going to conclude. Thank you very much for your attention.